so much for tuning in to yet another episode of OutBüro Voices, where we bring you community leaders, entrepreneurs, and professionals within the LGBT community. And today, we have a fantastic guest. His name is Paul Lorenz. Welcome, Paul. Thank you for joining us here on the show.
Well, thank you, Dennis, for this opportunity. I'm really happy to be here with you.
I've enjoyed our dialogue in the past. He is an artist and a multi-disciplinary artist in both music and visual. So now I've seen some of your work, and I'll actually put links into the show page and so forth as well, so that people can check out your website and some of the recent videos and so forth that you've sent me via Facebook and all of that. But Paul, give us a little bit of a brief overview of what your focus is, and then let's talk a little bit of let's wind back the clock and talk a little bit of how you got into this space and why you're focusing on it.
This is a very complicated question, but basically, I've been an artist all of my life, and there's been a few ideas that I follow, and they have led me through visual arts, architecture, performance, sound, and music. So right now, I'm concentrating on things I can do on my computer. Digital imagery, digital collage, and video using readily available images, things that I've photographed. And the digital imagery really is looking back through decades of photographs, seeing what I could do fresh with them. What else can happen with these images? Images of me, images of travel, images of past artworks. I mean, everything is fair game and everything is open to reinterpretation. So that's kind of what I'm working on right now. The building where my studio is in has just reopened maybe about a month ago. It's in Phoenix, Arizona. And I go there to work on messy things, paintings, drawings, maybe 2-3 times a week. So there's the home studio is the clean space. The studio at the art center is the messy space.
Let me clarify for those viewing. Not sure if it's latency on the video throughput on the Wi-Fi. Don't know if I'll be able to match up or not, but the video and the audio are kind of coming in a very artistic format. so it's not 100% match. So I just wanted to let the audience know that the audio is coming in clear that I can tell, but there's some lag and it's not 100% match. So we're just going to call it that this is your artistic expression as well.
I can run with that. That's okay.
Okay. And it will be also a podcast over 13 app. We'll just work with the video as best it can. So is your art space or your messy work, as you put it, is that kind of one large open space where being close together with people would be an issue? Or is it more of a private studio within it, like a building?
It's actually a really interesting situation. The building I'm in is called Shane Land Arts, and it's a brand new LGBTQ art center in Phoenix. And it's a one large space, which has a classroom. It's got retail space. It's got an art gallery. And then there are 4 small art studios that are open to the public. And that's where I work and 3 other artists. So when we're in there, the public can come in and they can do shopping, they can take an art class, or they can come and watch us and have a conversation. It's fun. People come by and they can engage with me as much as they want, or just take a look and not bother me or whatever. This isn't the first time I've worked in a public space for my studio, so I'm kind of used to being on display in that that manner. If I'm really concentrating on something, I can tune out people around me. But if I'm just starting something or just having some fun messing around, it kind of encourages people to ask questions.
You said you've been an artist most of your life. So has it always been kind of the coalescing of the different media forms, or did you start off with one over the other?
From a very young age, I started learning the piano as a child. I was introduced to oil painting in high school, and I've always been fascinated by architecture and structure and volume. And they've always been very separate things. And when I went to start college, my parents made it very clear I was not going to study fine art. And studying at the time, going into music wasn't something I wanted to do. So I decided on architecture. And that education in architecture has really been the backbone of everything I do, trying to figure out space and density and line. And this idea of a line, how to draw a line, the numerous ways of drawing a line, painting a line, led to wondering, well, what does a line sound like? This was, I think, 2007 or 2009, I forget. I was at a concert and I found the concert was dissonant and brutal. And the orchestra was set up so that it was around the perimeter of the space and the audience was sitting in the center. And we were encouraged at the midpoint of the concert to get up and move, because depending on where you sat in the space, the sound was different. And it was a life-changing moment, this concert. And the composer of the piece was a Greek composer, Yannis Xenakis, that I had never heard of. But I investigated him when I got home. And it turns out he was a structural engineer and he used his structural drawings as the basis for his music. And having my background in architecture, I know what he's doing. I can figure this out. And that's what led me into the whole idea of sound, what a line sounds like. Because like much like my drawings, which are about density and drawing a line, I could figure out, given geometry, given horizontal axis and a vertical axis, what a line sounds like. The more lines you have, the more dense the music gets. All of these things start playing together. So when I was feeling confident about the music, because I would go into recording studios with some engineers, and the music I drew was great for engineers because it's all based on math and it's based on time. Holding a note for 4 seconds, 2 seconds, a quarter of a second. Not good for musicians, but good for engineers. But when I was feeling confident about that idea sounded and I did enough work, I decided to go for a master's degree in music composition, which I just graduated from in 2019, which was a completely eye-opening thing. I'm the with all of these musicians, and I was like coming at it from a completely different way than a musician does. So there was a lot of relearning and remembering. I stopped playing the piano when I was graduated high school. So suddenly 40 years later to suddenly be thrown back into music and having to remember how to write music and all of the symbols and all of the markings you need to make music clear. It was a little challenging.
I could not imagine, frankly, even though I do love learning something every day, I could not possibly imagine of going back to a college format to get a degree in something right now, at this particular stage in my life, especially.
I had been going for a master's degree for decades, and I just never decided what I wanted to do with it. Because after being a painting, really, I was a painter for many, many years. It seemed very anticlimactic to suddenly go for a master's in fine art in painting. It's like, well, I've kind of done that. But music and my ideas about it were brand new, were really still developing in me. So like, well, if I'm going to do this, then let's do it. Not beat around the bush. Let's just dive in and apply someplace. So I got online, and the first college that came up was the Vermont College of Fine Arts. And they just started a MFA in music composition. And it just sounded right. It was a low residency where I would work in my home studio and then be on campus twice a year to have work played, to have live one-on-one rapport with my advisors and other teachers. So it seemed really perfect. Then I get to go to Vermont, which is a state I've never been to. So it seemed everything was just aligning. It's like, let's do this. So I applied, and it took the university, the college, it took them a little while to decide whether they wanted me or not, because I don't have a background in music, but they felt that my art practice was rigorous enough and my ideas were interesting enough. So they said, sure, you can come in. The first residency, it was so challenging. It's like, as with a background in architecture and fine art, I was not really speaking the same language as the musicians that were there. It was almost sheer disaster. I decided, no, pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You've got a certain skill set that they don't have. So work with this. Be yourself. Do what you do and see what happens. And actually, it was really it was an interesting time to have these ideas get pushed. As an artist, you always want to be pushed. You always want to be, you want to stay curious. You want to find answers. And that's a huge part of being an architect, is that you are a problem solver. You're always trying to be clear. You're always trying to find the best way to do something, but that's not always evident. So
while pushing the boundaries.
Exactly. Especially when you don't know what the boundaries are. As a painter, I know what I do and I know how it feels to reach a conclusion. With the music, I didn't know what that was. I didn't even know what questions to ask myself. So it was a very different mindset to be in. It took a lot of just living and experience and being part of things. I had one advisor who would always tell me, it's like, make a list of the sounds you like. And that became a whole basis for a piece of music. Or looking at an instrument and looking at how it works, much like a building. How do we want to move through this space? What does this instrument do? I was specifically using, and it was like, as it's a pair of lungs, it inhales and it exhales. And that became the basis for a piece of music. How long can you make this thing exhale? And how long can you make it inhale? What sound comes out of that if you don't touch any of the keys, if you don't do anything? And it became a kind of an endurance piece for the musicians, because I put a lot of bigger parameters on them than even the instrument is capable of. So architecture and music go very much hand in hand, and kind of filmmaking also, because you need a lot of people to get to an end result. Whereas painting and drawing, you can be solo and be in your little world and make things happen. But if you want to make music, you need musicians, and you need to tell them what to do, and you need to massage that. As a painter, I like chance. I like making mistakes and then trying to work my way out. Musicians don't always like to do that. They like to have things very clearly in front of them so they can perform. And when I expect them, it's like, well, you just think about it and interpret it your way. You don't necessarily want to interpret it. We want you to tell us. So there's always that give and take with musicians. The same thing in architecture with contractors. They want to know exactly what they need to do. It's like, oh, let's figure out the tile pattern as you're doing it. Setting up circumstances that may not work, but then trusting myself to create the resolve, to finish the piece, to make it whole. So it's always risk and control that play with everything I kind of do.
Thank you so much for participating with me today and sharing your story about your artwork. Very interesting. And for you out in the audience, thank you for tuning in today. Be sure to subscribe or follow in whichever application you are listening to. Thank you so much. This is Dennis Velco with OutBüro. Have a great day.